Hello friends, this is second part of the lecture on research publication and research quality indicators. In part one, we studied or we discussed that what is research, why to publish research papers, and we discussed academic ethics in terms of plagiarism. In this lecture, we will be discussing what are different softwares that can be used for the plagiarism check. Then we will discussing two main research quality indicators which are nowadays asked by everybody, whether you go for any research grant, whether you go for any interview, etc. And one of them is related with the journals in which you publish, that is impact factor. And second one is related with an individual as a scientist or with a department or with a research group or with a university, that is based upon the citation of the research, that is H-index. So let us start with plagiarism checkers. There are number of softwares which are available for the plagiarism check. Some of them are free softwares, those are available online, and some of them are paid softwares. If I talk about free softwares that are available online, that include PledgeScan, then Whisper, etc. If you open your computer and in the Google, you just put free online plagiarism checkers, you will find a big list. But there is a drawback of these plagiarism checkers, that the database or the library with which they will compare your document, that is your thesis or your research paper, that is very small. They compare your document only with the open or online resources which are open with them only. So the report which we get, that is very, you can say, small. Over there the comparison is with a very lesser number of documents. There are another softwares, those are paid softwares and have a bigger library or bigger database for comparison. I'll be talking mainly about three, or two of them rather. I have given the names of three here. One of them is Urkund, second of them is Turnitin, and third one is Authenticate. So let me discuss about them one by one. Let me first take Urkund. Urkund software is provided free of cost to those universities which are eligible to get the grants from the UGC and or approved under 2F and 12B. Basically, all such institutes have to sign a MOU with InfLibNet. You might be knowing about InfLibNet. InfLibNet is also a unit of UGC and that is based in Gandhinagar. So the institute that is eligible for grant has to sign a MOU with the InfLibNet, and then InfLibNet will give them free access to the Urkund. Basically, what will happen, that InfLibNet will write to the Urkund, and then that Urkund will send you a email. So when you put in the Google Urkund, or when you open the website of Google, this Urkund, this page will open, and on this page, if you see in the right hand top corner, there is login. So just click this login. When you will click this login, this page will open with access portal, and here again there is the Urkund system and login option is there. You click this login option. When you will click this login option, then this login page will open. When this login page will open, first you have to put your email ID and the password. This email is your email, and the password means account should be there of yours if you want to use the Urkund. And for that, you will get, as I told earlier, a access from the InfliptNet. So I think this is mostly available with most of the universities. Today, while searching the website of InfliptNet, I found there are about more than 150 institutes that have been given free access of Urkund by the InfliptNet. And if you are not having this in your institute, but you are eligible to get the grant from UGC, then you write to the InfliptNet and they will give you access. And then through your library or through your librarian, you can get the account be created for every faculty member to screen your documents for plagiarism or for similarity. Here I am showing you my own account on the Urkund. Once you log in, then this kind of page will open, and this screenshot is showing that I have scanned a number of documents. So here you will find somewhere this similarity is 19%, somewhere 10%, somewhere 20%, and for one document this is showing that the similarity is 91%. What is the meaning of this? We should understand. 91% means this document was scanned by me earlier also, and some similarity was there. So, and similarity report was provided by the Urkund. To overcome the, to take care of that similarity, we made the changes in the document, and the document was again uploaded on the website of the Urkund to get the report of similarity. And in the second report, it shows 91% similarity. Actually, whenever we upload a document, that document is retained in the library by the Urkund. So when we scan second time the same article, it is compared with the article that is retained in the library or in the database by the Urkund. So certainly this document is document number 2 has been prepared after making the modifications in the document number, its similarity is going to increase. So how to overcome this situation? Actually, when you will be scanning, then on the right hand side, the list of all the documents will be given with which you have to compare the similarity. So over there is an option whether it should be included while calculating the similarity or not. So if you say no for that, there is an option for that, then it will not be included, and certainly this similarity will reduce. Once the document is uploaded on the Urkund, you will receive one email, that is the receipt that document has been uploaded, and after a few minutes you will get a report. Report can be seen on the website of the Urkund in your account also, as well as Urkund will send one email to the email account that was used as login email ID. So over there also you can get. Here I have shown a screenshot of one of my document that I scanned on the Urkund, and you will find here in this screenshot in the subject that this is showing 18% similarity, as well as there is a link if given in this email. If I click this link, this will take me to the website of the Urkund, and over there I can find out each and every document with which my article has been compared. So to summarize about Urkund is provided free to all universities or colleges by InfliptNet, subject to the condition that university or college or institute should be eligible to get grant from the UGC. The second software that can be used for plagiarism check is Turnitin. Turnitin is used in a number of institutes, and this is considered as more authentic because its database with which your article is compared is much bigger as compared to the other software.
years.
Cost of the basic version of Turnitin is in the range of $5,000 to $6,000 for 1 year. You may get subscription for annual basis, or you may get subscription for 3 years also. Certainly for 3 years you have to pay more. So in the basic version, you get about 30 to 35 licenses, means you can open 30 to 35 accounts in the Turnit if you purchase the basic version. Let me have a look on the Turnitin, that how it works. The website of this Turnitin is turnitin.com. Even if you don't remember the website, just in the Google type Turnitin, and the very first website that will open, that is shown here in this screenshot, will be of Turnitin Home. Just click on this. When you will click on this, this will take you to the web page of Turnitin, and this slide shows the web page of Turnitin, in which it is written that education with integrity. I'll request you all, please have a look on this website. Lot of information with respect to ethics in academics, with respect to plagiarism, with respect to similarity, with respect to academic integrity, etc., is given over there. Once this page is open, then at the top corner on the right hand side, there is login provision. As this is a paid software for plagiarism check, everybody cannot login into it. Only those are having access to login, those have purchased this software, can only login into it. Over there, again, you put your email address and you put your password. Then it will take you to the uploading page. On the uploading page, you can make different folders, means one folder may be for the assignments of the student, one may be for the thesis scanning, one may be for the research papers, one may be for the master's students, one may be for the M.Tech students, one may be for the M.Phil students, like that. You can make a number of folders into that. And then there is a provision to upload your document. Once the document is uploaded, the report will be generated, and then you can see the report. I have generated one report to show you on the Turnitin. I would like to show that report to you. So when report will come, the first page will of that report will show you the name of the article given by you, as well as the name of the author. At the bottom of the first page, you will again find all information, that on which date it was scanned, at what time it was scanned, what is its submission ID, as well as even the word count and character count you will find over there. This is a very important page, because if at a later stage, suppose this article is maintained in the library and you again compare your article with that, certainly after revision you again scan your this article or your thesis, certainly similarity will increase. So if anybody raise any question at a later stage, you can say that document is also yours document, that is saved in the database or the library of the Turnitin by your name only. So this page is very important. So in the report, the lines or the words which are having similarity with the other documents available in the database of Turnitin are highlighted. I have shown you here one page, and with every line you will find in this orange color or blue color some numbers are given. Basically, these numbers are given to the documents from in which these lines are available. That I will be showing you later on. So when you scan your article on the Turnitin, you can set the word limit also. Means, I put the word limit of 14 words, means don't show those lines in the similarity which are having lesser than 14 words similar to the other document. Many people keep it to 30 words, some keep it to the 10 words. This is up to you, or this is up to your institute, that up to what level you want to compare. I personally usually compare a line up to 14 words. So once, let me show you another page also of the similarity report. Here also you will find the several lines have been highlighted. Once this report is available to me, now I can make the changes in the article, and after making the changes, I will again run this article on the Turnitin and try to bring the similarity of this article to less than 10%. So I'll also suggest you that whenever you submit an article, try to bring its similarity lesser than 10%. Then at the end of the Turnitin report, you will find a page like this. So all information is given in this page. This shows that this article is having 23% similarity with other documents. Out of them, this is having 14% similarity with the internet sources and 24% similarity with the publication and 0% similarity with some student paper, assignments, thesis, etc. And here the list of all the articles is given with which this similarity has been compared. If you see the article number 1, so this report says that 9% similarity is there with this single article. Basically, this article is also of almost similar nature with few changes. Basic philosophy of this article and the research that has been scanned is almost same. So after obtaining this report, I can make the changes in my article. Here I would also like to mention that the same article was scanned on the Urkund also. Over there was 18% similarity, and here in Turnitin this similarity is 23%. This shows that the certainly database of Urkund is smaller than the database of Turnitin. The report which we get from the Turnitin is more refined as compared to the Urkund. But Turnitin not available to everyone, because this is a paid software, whereas Urkund is provided by InfibNet to all the institutes eligible for grant from the UGC. The third software that I mentioned was Authenticate. Authenticate is generally used by the good quality journals. Whenever you submit your article, normally what editors do, or assistant editors or whatever it is, they compare your, means they scan your article and using Authenticate or Turnitin, and if they find the similarity is high, they return back your article or simply they reject this article. So to avoid this step, I'll suggest you that before submitting your article, always ensure that its similarity is lesser than 10%. Now the question arises that how to select a right journal for publishing our scientific research or scientific manuscript. While deciding a journal, you have to take several points into your consideration, and these points include impact factor of the journal, whether journal is having open access or not, peer review is done by the journal or not, and if the peer review is done, then how much time is taken for the peer review and how many peer reviews are there. In most of the journal, there are generally 2 to 3 peer reviews, but in some cases I have found even 5 reviewers, and for one journal I found even 10 reviewers. So more the impact factor of the journal, certainly the number of reviews will, peer reviews will increase. Then who is the journal's readership, whether these are students, whether this is faculty, researchers, professors, so like that. Then you should know the type of articles published in that article. Suppose there is a journal of chemistry, and if you send an article of social science in that journal or of computer science in that chemistry journal, this is for sure that your article is going to be rejected outrightly. So avoid such kind of things. Then most of the journals put a page limit or word limit, means they put a limit of the length of the manuscript. Always follow that. Suppose your article is 40-50% bigger or having more length or more number of words than the maximum permissible limit, it's better either to reduce your article or to select some other journal that accept bigger articles. Then in that situation, the another option is the publication of supplementary data. There are several journals which don't put some of your figures, some of your tables, some of your data in the main article. Rather, they give a link to publish this data as the supplementary data. So if anybody is interested in those figures or tables, just by clicking the supplementary data link will reach to that data and can see that data. The another point is the reputation of the journal, means who is the publisher and editorial team, etc. And another point that is to be considered is the acceptance and rejection rate. Basically, acceptance and rejection rate depends on 2-3 factors. One of them is the impact factor. If the impact factor of a journal is high, generally the rejection rate is very high. If secondly, it depends upon the number of articles published by that journal. If the more number of articles are published, certainly there are chances of a higher acceptance rate. If lesser number of articles are published, then there are chances of the lesser acceptance rate. Another point is quality of accepted articles. There are a number of journals, some of them are paid journals in the name of open access journal also. I personally have observed and found that you send any article, that article will be accepted. So you please look the quality of accepted articles or published article before submitting your article to that particular journal. And then another important point is the indexing and the circulation, means the audience size. Means any journal which is having more indexing, more circulation, certainly you will get better readership. And if you will get better readership, there are quite good chances that your article will be cited more and more. And when there will be more citation of your article, certainly you are going to get good H-index, etc. And that will be helpful in getting the research grants, etc. So that we are going to discuss now. In the whole discussion, one word has appeared several times, that is impact factor. Let me discuss what is this impact factor. Nowadays, impact factor is considered as an indicator of the quality of your research. This impact factor concept was given or devised by using Garfield. Basically, impact factor is used to compare the journals in a field. Question arises that how this impact factor is calculated. Suppose we want to calculate the impact factor for 2018 for a journal. So this impact factor is calculated by dividing the number of citations made in 2018 to items published in the previous 2 years by the total number of articles and reviews published in the previous 2 years. Impact factor tells you that how often articles published in a journal are cited during their year of publication. Basically, impact factor is used as an indication that how hot or how popular or how important that journal is. Impact factors are calculated yearly starting from 1975 for journals listed in the journal citation reports. Impact factors are calculated yearly starting from 1975 for journals listed in the journal citation report. Now, what is this journal citation report? Journal citation report is an annual publication by Clarivate Analytics. Previously, the intellectual property of Thomson Reuters means earlier these impact factors of the journals were published or given by the Thomson Reuters, but now these are given by the Clarivate Analytics. JCR is basically is a report, and this is normally given in the month of June or July every year. The impact factors given in 2018 were the impact factors of 2017, and in 2019 we will get the impact factors of 2018. In this year's JCR, the total number of journals was approximately 9,000 which were having some impact factor. Impact factor is calculated up to 3 decimal points. Some of the journals which have very high impact factors are say Nature, Science, Chemical Reviews, etc. And here I would also like to mention one thing. No need to be worried that X professor or X student or X faculty has published article in a very high impact factor and my publication is in a low impact factor journal. I'll suggest colleagues, if you make any comparison, although comparison should not be made, but in case you make any comparison, compare yourself within your own field. For example, normally the impact factor of science journals is higher. So, a social science person should not compare himself with the physics people or chemistry people or with some medicine people or pharmacy people, because in the social sciences the impact factors are comparatively lower. Similarly, in computer sciences also the impact factors are comparatively lesser as compared to the other sciences. This slide shows that how the impact factors are calculated. If you want to calculate the impact factor for the year Y, that is equal to the citations, total citations in the year Y minus 1 plus citations in Y minus 2 year divided by publications in Y minus 1 year plus publications in Y minus 2 year. So just below this formula, one example of a very reputed journal, that is Nature, has been given, and the impact factor of this journal in 2014 was 41.456, and how this was calculated, let us see. So the impact factor in 2014 is equal to the all citations of the articles in 2013 plus citations in 2012 divided by the publications articles published in 2013 plus publications in 2012. So here the values are given, that the total citations in 2013 were 29,753 and in 2012 these citations were 41,924, and this is divided by the articles that are published in these 2 years. In 2013, 860 articles were published, and in 2012, 869 articles were published, and finally we get the value 41.56. So like this, the impact factors are calculated for different journals. I hope you have got some idea of the impact factors. I am again brief, making things clear in 2-3 lines. Number one, impact factors are calculated for different journals. Impact factors are calculated means the citations in the previous 2 years divided by the publications in the previous 2 years, and in 2018 we will get the impact factor of 2017, and in 2019 we will get the impact factor for 2018. And don't compare yourself with the other fields, compare yourself within your area if you want to compare. Further, normally the impact factor of the science related journals are higher as compared to the social science journals. The another research quality indicator that is used nowadays is the H index. Let us try to understand that what is H index. H index is an index that attempts to measure both the productivity and impact of the published work of a scientist or a scholar or a faculty member. H index is based on the set of the scientists' most cited papers and the number of citations that you have received in other publications. H index can also be applied to the productivity and impact of a group of scientists, such as a department or university or country, as well as even for a scholarly journal. What I want to say that H index can be calculated for an individual, it can be calculated for a group of scientists, means for a research group, it can be calculated for a university, it can be calculated for the department of a university, it can be calculated for a state, it can be calculated for a country, or it can be calculated even for a journal. This idea of H index was suggested by Georgi Hirsche. He is a physicist, and this tool was given or suggested by him for determining theoretical physicists' relative quality, and is sometimes called the Hirsche index or Hirsch number. This figure shows that how H index can be calculated. On one axis, you will find the citations are given, and on the other axis, the number of research paper is given, and different research papers with their citation, they are given here. So you will find that at one point the citations are equal to papers, and that is your H index. Let me try to understand it in simple words. H index means that your n number of research papers have at least n citations. Suppose you have 5 research papers, one of them is having 100 citations, second is having 20 citations, third one is having 1 citation, fourth one is having 0 citation, and fifth one is 0 citation. So in that situation, you will find that there are only 2 research papers which are having at least 2 citations, it means your H index is 2. So when it will be 3, when the third paper, which is today having 1 citation, this will increase to 3, then you will be having at least 3 research papers which are having at least 3 citations, so your H index will be 3. If a scientist is having only 1 research paper and he is having even 10,000 citations for single article, the H index will always be 1. But suppose there is another person who is having 10 articles and each is cited only 10 times, it means 10 articles cited at least 10 times, his H index will be 10. So I think you are clear that how this H index is calculated. A scholar with an index of 40 means the scholar has published 40 research papers, each of which has been cited by others at least 40 times. Hirsche has given an estimate that after 20 years, a successful scientist will have a H index of 20. An outstanding scientist will have a H index of 40, and a truly unique scientist will have a H index of 60. However, he points out that value of H may vary between different fields, as I told earlier, in case of impact factor also. Because if you compare, you compare yourself within your field. The people, those are from physics, chemistry, environment science, or medicine or pharmacy, certainly their H index will be higher than the people those are working in the field of social sciences. But there are a number of situations in which H index may provide misleading information about a scientist's output. H index doesn't account for the number of authors of a paper. the H index is bounded by the number of publications. This means the scientists with a short career are at an inherent disadvantage regardless of the importance of their discoveries. Let me take some examples. There is a scientist, Evariste Galois. He published only 2 research papers, so his H index will never be more than 2. This is going to be only 2, although these 2 research papers are very, very important. Let me take another example of Albert Einstein. Albert Einstein published 4 groundbreaking papers in 1905. He even got Nobel Prize for his discoveries. Because he has published only 4 research papers, so in any situation, his H index is not going to be more than 4. It means H index doesn't indicate the importance of your research. The H index can be manipulated, or many people manipulate it by self-citations. Normally, I am asked a question by people that where we can get our H index. There are 2-3 sites where from you can get your H index, and these sites include Scopus, Google Scholar, Web of Science. Again, Scopus is a paid website and Web of Science is also a paid website, but Google Scholar is a open source. Normally you will find that the H index of a scientist or of a person is usually higher in the Google Scholar as compared to the Scopus and Web of Science. The reason is Google Scholar take all publications in which you are cited into their accounting, whereas Scopus and Web of Science have some limitations, means not only limitation, they have some limited, means they limit their database basically. They don't include all kind of publications in which we are cited for calculating the H index. So, to summarize this module, in this module we have discussed about different plagiarism check software. We discussed in detail Urkund, and we found that Urkund can be obtained by you in free from the InfliNet if you are eligible for grant from the UGC. Then second software which we discussed in detail is Turnitin. Turnitin is a paid software, and the cost of the basic version of Turnitin is about $5,000 to $6,000, where you will get about 30 to 35 licenses, means this number of accounts can be opened. Then we discussed 2 research quality indicators which are widely used nowadays. One of them is impact factor of the journals, and we also discussed that the how impact factor is calculated, and the another is the H index. H index can be for an individual, for a university, for a department, for a country, for a state. And we also discussed the limitations of the H index. And in last, we discussed about different websites from where we can find out this H index value. I hope you enjoyed these 2 modules. Thank you.